This section is on needle use, selection, and handling. And before we begin this discussion, I think it's always important to think about where am I going to give this injection and make sure that that injection site that we've picked is going to be clean to prevent contamination and abscesses, etc. The next thing is consider using a single-use disposable needle, and that's what we recommend, and that allows you to, each time you process cattle, to start with a clean needle and not have to worry about whether it was clean from the last time it was used. The next point is to keep contents of the pharmaceutical compound that you're administering, keep that bottle clean so that we do not contaminate that, and that means not storing needles and or syringes in the top of the bottle. And also not putting used needles back into that bottle. When we talk about transfer needles, they need to be stored in a clean container chute side so that they don't get contaminated during the workday. When we get done, we need to be these transfer needles need to be boiled and placed in a clean sealed container, okay, for the next time. And we also need to be cognizant that alcohol and disinfectants can deactivate modified live vaccines and certain pharmaceutical products. So never use alcohol or disinfectant to clean your needles and syringes. Okay, always use boiling and hot water, okay, to clean them. When we talk about selecting the proper needle gauge, the things to consider would be the route of administration. Are we going to give this injection intramuscularly? Are we going to do it sub-Q? Or are we going to give it intravenous? The size of the animal is also a consideration. These small animals have thin hides and they lack muscle over the skeleton, which means we probably need to use a smaller gauge needle and a shorter length. The site of the injection, of course, we always refer to the proper injection site as being in the neck in front of the shoulder. But we also have to consider where the shoulder is at, okay, and the muscle that lays over that skeletal structure or the scapula. And the vertebrae in the neck and where that's located at when we consider injection site. Another consideration is how fluid or how viscous the material is that we're going to be administering. Thicker products need larger diameter needles, talking about 16 to 18 gauge. The thinner fluids, we may be able to use a 20 or 22 gauge needle. And then the last consideration is what volume is going to be injected. If we're using a 2 mL vaccine, for example, the needle gauge could be a little bit smaller than if you're trying to give 10 cc's, okay, of an antibiotic. So the volume of the product, as that increases, the size of the needle diameter probably needs to increase up to and including of about a 16 gauge needle. Needle size, both length and gauge, should never be longer than necessary to perform the injection site that we're or the injection that we're planning. When we talk about needle size, you know, typically we're talking about 16 and 18 gauge needles for the most part. If we're talking about sub-Q injections, these needles need to be 5/8 to 1 inch in length. 5/8 would be the preferred one for the smaller weight cattle, up to the 1 inch in the heavier weight cattle and then maybe even in cows. When we go to intramuscular injections, we're talking about 1 to 1.5 inch long needles. Again, the smaller weight cattle ought to be in that 18 to 20 gauge needle category, and as these cattle get heavier, you might think about the 16 to 18 gauge, okay, which would be a little bit larger in diameter. When we give IV injections, those needles could be in the neighborhood of 1.5 inches. Again, 16 gauge needles on the lightweight cattle. And as we get to the heavier weight cattle, we might even be able to go to a 14 gauge needle. But I would only use 14 gauge whenever I'm doing an IV injection and not when I'm using sub-Q or IM, because that's a large hole and we can get leakage of our pharmaceutical product. Changing needles becomes important. We recommend changing needles every 10 to 15 animals, or when you refill the automatic syringe when you're using vaccines, for example. Any needle that is contaminated by dirt, manure, chemical, it needs to be changed at that point when it becomes contaminated. If a needle gets bent, it needs to be replaced. Remember that broken needles are an emergency event. And if a needle is broken off inside one of these animals, that needle will migrate further into the tissue. Under no circumstances should an animal be sold or sent to the packer with a broken needle. That needle needs to be removed before that animal is harvested, and that may require the assistance of a veterinarian to accomplish that. We do not want the consumer to experience a broken needle. If we need to be cognizant of spreading blood-borne infections like anaplasmosis, for example, then a new needle ought to be used on every animal. Some of our recommendations would be to use disposable needles and syringes whenever possible, heat sterilize reusable equipment by boiling and not using alcohol or disinfectants to clean. We also need to consider, how do we dispose of these needles once we've used them, or what some people would refer to as the sharps. A thick plastic container with a secure lid needs to be used, and there are specific commercially available sharps containers, and of course those are the best to use. But in lieu of that, a liquid detergent bottle that's made of heavy plastic can also work. Whenever you get that container filled, dispose of it as a solid waste by placing that sharps container in a rigid container lined with plastic. So in summary, use the correct gauge needle and length, okay, when giving injections. Change needles frequently. Never use a bent or burred needle. Okay, the burred needles will cause injection site blemishes that will last the lifetime of that animal. Keep pharmaceutical bottles sterile and properly dispose of used needles.